action.
I was born in England in 1960 and lived there till I was 8 years old. After that, I moved with my family to Sri Lanka, where I lived till I was 15. In Sri Lanka, I lived in the hill town of Kandy, which was a town of about 500,000 people, and I attended a private boys' school, which was based on a very distorted view of the old supposed English academic system, where there were canings and school detentions and a great deal of misinformation taught to me in school. While I was in Sri Lanka, I also developed an huge interest in animals and insects in particular, and birds, and became an insatiable collector of things. I collected butterflies, and I collected shells, and I collected rocks and feathers, and anything that was to do with the natural world. I was also very interested in evolution, and maintained this interest in science generally right throughout my life. When I went to the University of Queensland in 1978, I had completed 2 years in the Church of England Boys Grammar School, which was a private boys school, an Anglican school in Brisbane, and I had studied science there. Physics and mathematics and chemistry, as well as English and Christianity. I've been brought up with Church of England views, which I had rejected when I was about 15, and lost all interest in philosophy or religion, and dedicated my interest to science. When I went to the University of Queensland, though, I studied medicine, so I learned more science. But the science that I learned at the University of Queensland wasn't very good science. It was very splintered. It was a whole lot of little bits of information which didn't connect, a whole lot of things about drugs and diagnosis of illness, but very little about people, very little about communication, nothing about love, nothing about creativity, nothing about happiness, nothing about philosophy, nothing about the philosophy of science. And very little about psychology. What we did learn about psychology was really quite distorted. The book that we studied psychology from was this book, Psychology and Life by Philip Zimbardo from Stanford University in America. This was the prescribed textbook in psychology at the University of Queensland. It's a pretty strange book. It starts off with the claim that psychology is scientific. It says, it is formally defined as the study of the behavior of organisms. The rest of the book goes on to focus largely on ideas of psychology based on animal experimentation. And this animal experimentation, in addition to being extremely cruel, is very misleading because it focuses on negative aspects of animal behavior in captive and traumatic conditions to the animal. So in terms of emotions, they tend to study fear and anger rather than love or aesthetic pleasure. You can't really study how much pleasure an animal or a bird gets from perception of the beauty around them by electrocuting their brains. You can't understand much about monkeys and how monkeys communicate, again by electrocuting bits of their brain or chopping them up, which is what experimental psychologists have been doing for many years in universities in America and Australia and England. Psychology and Life is a book that gives many conflicting and strange theories about emotions and psychology generally. It talks little about belief systems. It talks a little bit about the brain, But what it does say about the brain leaves out a number of very important things. Part of my journey from 1995 onwards has been in search of information about the pineal. The pineal is a little organ in the brain that is known to calcify, and that is really all I learned in medical school. Psychology and Life doesn't mention the pineal at all. This book was written in 1978. The pineal was thought to be a vestigial organ right up until 1958. A vestigial organ means that it was thought to be a useless primitive remnant of primitive animals such as reptiles and birds. But the pineal has a long history in Eastern philosophy as well as in Western philosophy, in that Descartes believed that the pineal was the seat of the soul or the seat of wisdom. This has been laughed at by the medical establishment or scientific establishment when in fact they heard about it, if they heard about it. I didn't hear anything about it when I was at medical school. The reason is that science doesn't believe in concepts of soul or a soul. Science doesn't believe in concepts of God. Science doesn't believe in concepts that are not measurable in mathematics, or certainly this is the sort of science that I was taught when I was in medical school. It was all about statistics. It was all about measuring things in numbers, and it's very hard to measure emotions in numbers. Therefore, emotions were discounted, or emotions were considered to be negative things. Emotionality usually meant somebody who cried a lot, rather than a person who felt great bliss or joy.